Do you want to know how to install Manjaro Linux on a laptop? I will walk you step by step through the installation process and also show you what I do right after the installation to optimize the system. So keep watching. Hi everybody, welcome to the Digital Life. My name is Christian and I'm always teaching you how to become an IT professional. So when you're interested in learning Linux, Python, networking, cloud and all those stuff, don't forget to subscribe to my channel. So in today's video we will install Manjaro Linux on a new laptop I recently bought. It's not a very expensive one, but it has some great hardware components installed. It has an i5 processor, 8GB of RAM, an SSD hard disk and also a dedicated graphics card from Nvidia, the MX150. I'm choosing Manjaro Linux because it's a very nice and powerful Linux distribution and it offers a lot of great tools like the Arch user repository, and it also has a great and very informative documentation. It's based on Arch Linux, where you also can find a lot of great articles, a lot of great tools and resources. So it's a great choice for a Linux distribution in my opinion. I'm using the XFCE desktop environment because it's very lightweight and optimized for speed, and overall I just like the simple and minimalistic look and feel of it. For those of you who have never installed a Linux system like this before, I would first recommend to install it in a virtual test environment, because for pure beginners it's often better to use a sheltered area to do the first steps. Because when you break your system, you can easily revert it without damaging your physical computer and start from scratch. And for anyone else who just wants to see how to install Manjaro on a laptop, let's step right into the installation process. To install Manjaro on a laptop, you first need to download the official ISO file from the homepage manjaro.org. Click on the left button, Try Manjaro. And then you can choose one of the different desktop environments. There is XFCE, KDE and GNOME 3. There's also an Architect version, which comes without any graphical user interface, so that is just for advanced Linux users. I choose the XFCE desktop, just click on that button, and then you can download the 64-bit version. There's also a minimal desktop environment image that comes with no additional software packages pre-installed. When you click on download, you can also see some great articles and tutorials how to create a USB stick or how to use a virtual machine. Just click on Take me to downloads and it will download the ISO file. Once the download of the ISO file has finished, you now need to put that on a USB drive and plug it into the laptop. To do that, you can use the free available software tool called Rufus. You will find a download link in the description below. First, select your USB drive and then open the ISO file you want to put on that USB stick. When you have inserted the Manjaro ISO file, then finally click on Start. Be careful, the Rufus tool needs to erase all files that are located on your USB drive. Click on OK and wait until the image is written to the USB stick. It is now complete. You can close the Rufus tool now and plug your USB disk into your laptop. When you plugged in the USB stick, you should first need to boot the laptop into the BIOS. If you don't know how to do that, please refer to the official documentation of your laptop vendor's homepage, because this can be different for any laptop model. This example is how the BIOS of my laptop looks like. The first thing you should do is to go to the boot section and disable secure boot if it is enabled. Next thing is you need to change the boot order so that your USB disk is the first priority for the boot process. You should also have a look at the SATA mode, because on my laptop model it was set to RST with Intel Optane. This is a technology that is not supported by Linux yet. That option is enabled on some laptop models that are shipped with a modern NVMe hard disk, instead of a common SSD drive. If you see that option, you should change it to AHCI. But be careful if you want to continue using Windows on this laptop in dual boot mode or something else. When you change the SATA mode, you need to reinstall Windows 10 because you are not able to boot up Windows 10 successfully anymore. Okay, we now can save the changes into the BIOS and reboot our computer. When the laptop has successfully booted from the Manjaro installer, you will see this screen here. I first will set my time zone to Europe, Berlin, and change the key table to German. Then I will select the correct drivers which Manjaro should install. So you can choose between free and non-free drivers. This mainly applies to the drivers of your graphics card. So when you select free, Manjaro will install with the free open source drivers that mainly support your graphics card. But they are a bit slower and you probably want to use the non-free drivers instead, which are shipped from your official graphics card vendor. This makes sense because they tend to be much more performant. But don't worry if you should forget that. You could change it after the installation with some shell commands that are described on the official Manjaro documentation homepage. But I will continue to use the non-free drivers in order to make the installer directly install the correct supported vendor drivers. Okay, we now can boot up Manjaro and start the installation. When Manjaro has booted, just click on Launch Installer. Note that you will need to have an internet connection before doing that, otherwise you will get this error message here. When you have set up your internet connection, click on Next, and then you will need to set your location, the correct keyboard layout, and then you can select how Manjaro should be installed on your hard disk. You can see I already have installed Manjaro Linux in version 19.0.2 on this hard disk. If you already have installed an operating system on your hard disk, you can select Install Alongside. This will split the partition on your hard disk and install Manjaro in a dual boot mode. For example, when you already have Windows 10 installed on this hard disk. But remember, when you change your SATA mode, you will not be able to do that. So in my case, I will just use Erase Disk, and then you can select if you want the installer to create a swap partition. A swap partition is only very helpful when you have a low amount of memory installed in your computer, because when Linux runs out of memory, it will start to outsource some of the RAM value to the hard disk. Of course, this is not very performant, and when you have at least 4 gigs of RAM, you can just continue with no swap partition. I'm also setting the computer name, a strong password, and select the option to use the same password for the administrator account. I won't install any Office Suite on this computer. I know you can basically click on Install Now, and the installer will then start to install Manjaro on your hard disk. So, it's time for a short coffee break now, but I will skip it on the video. Okay, you can now unplug your USB hard disk and restart your computer. Okay, we have just installed Manjaro Linux on this laptop here. It's running very smooth and fast, and we can now start to optimize the system after the installation. There are a few things I would do right after the installation. The first one is I will show you how to switch the branch. Manjaro Linux has three different branches: the stable, unstable, and testing branch. If you are using Manjaro as your day-to-day desktop computer, I would recommend to continue with the stable branch, because the unstable branch often has some bugs, and if you run into issues, you might struggle with fixing them because you need to have a decent knowledge of Linux in order to do that. I will also show you how to add or remove any additional software with the Packet Manager, and also how to enable the Arch User Repository, because you will find lots of great tools and applications that are not available in the official Manjaro repository. You will also need to take care of which graphics drivers you have installed. We will check if we have the correct non-free drivers from the NVIDIA graphics card installed. And I will also show you how to run applications that are rendered on the NVIDIA graphics card. Because I have two graphics chips installed, I have an Intel processor that has an internal graphics chip and also the dedicated graphics card from NVIDIA, the MX150. On Linux, this is a kind of a special case when it comes to two graphics cards, because you may know it from Windows when you're just using your desktop or surfing on the internet or write emails. You will mainly use the Intel processor's graphic chip in order to save power. And when you start a computer game or start rendering software that needs to consume much more hardware power, it will handle this application via the dedicated NVIDIA graphics card. This is called Prime GPU offloading, and it's supported in Linux since beginning of this year with the official driver version, so it's pretty new. You will also find lots of outdated information on the internet or even on YouTube. If you're watching this video, it might be even outdated as well. So don't trust blindly any YouTuber. Check the official Manjaro documentation for any updates. I will also install some software and tools that I'm using in my day-to-day work, so you get a bit of insight of what applications I'm using. Okay, so let's have a look at that. Okay, when you have booted up Manjaro, you will see this welcome screen here. I will now show you how you can switch the branch if you want to, but as I said, only consider doing that when you have a decent knowledge of Linux and you want to fix some problems yourself. Okay, to do that, just open a terminal. And on the terminal, you can simply check which branch is currently used by Manjaro when you use this command here. By default, Manjaro uses a stable branch. To switch to the unstable branch, just execute this command here. And when you execute it, it will switch the branch and download the new mirrors from the repository. This may take some time. I will also execute the fast track command. With this command, Manjaro will only use the fastest mirrors available. And after you have changed the branch, you need to rebuild the mirror list and update all your packages. Just confirm the installation of all those packages. Okay, so I've now switched the branch to the unstable. I now will continue and install an Arch User Repository helper that is called Trizen. You can install it with this command here. We will use the Arch User Repository helper later to install applications from the terminal that are maintained by the community. If you prefer the graphical version of the Packet Manager, you just can type in add or remove software. And with this Packet Manager, you can also go to preferences and enable the Arch User Repository. This will also show packages that are maintained by the community in the Packet Manager. Next, we will check if Manjaro has installed the correct non-free drivers for my NVIDIA graphics card. You can do it with this command here. You can see here are my two graphics cards, the Intel UHD graphics and the NVIDIA graphics. On the third line, you can see the driver is set to mode setting and NVIDIA. That indicates that the correct non-free drivers from NVIDIA have been installed automatically by Manjaro. So this looks fine. It should also have installed some utility tools from NVIDIA. Just enter NVIDIA settings in the taskbar. And there you can see all settings and details of your graphics card, such as GPU temperature, application profiles, and so on. On Linux, there are multiple ways to configure graphics drivers, but when you just selected the non-free drivers, everything should work fine. Anyway, if you have trouble in this area, I can just recommend searching for support on the Arch user forum or on the Manjaro Linux forum. Okay. So we have now installed the correct drivers, but when we now start an application, this is not yet handled by the NVIDIA's graphics card. And that is because the Prime GPU offloading needs to be triggered by a command or by the user. You can also use some environment variables for that, but I will show you an easy way to do that, and let me demonstrate that with a simple test. I'm using the tool GLX Gears, which is a small benchmarking tool. It renders some 3D graphics, really, really simple. And you can see the benchmark values such as frames per second and so on. Now we need to find out which graphics card is used to render that kind of application. So let's do a simple test. I will open a second terminal window. And I'm using the tool NVIDIA-SMI that will output all processes that are currently rendered by the NVIDIA graphics card. You can see there's currently only one process that is rendered via the NVIDIA graphics card. Let's do a watch command in front of that so we will get an update every second of all those processes. Now we will start GLX Gears. And you can see there's no change on the left window, so no process is rendered by the graphics card. And that's because Linux doesn't know it yet that it should render this via the NVIDIA card. To do that, let's use the prime-run command in front of the GLX Gears application. And when we execute it, you can see on the left side of the window, the process GLX Gears is now rendered correctly by the NVIDIA graphics card. So when you use that command in front of any application that uses rendering graphics, you will get much more graphic power on it. Okay, I know we'll do some other settings that are not actually important, but to just show you how to do that, let's open the XFCE settings manager. And the first thing I will do on every new desktop environment, I will change it to dark mode, because I'm a real dark mode fan on any system. You can also change it in the LightDM Greeter. This application is basically the login screen of Manjaro. And next, I will open the Power Manager and enable the brightness keys on my notebook. With these keys, I can adjust the brightness of the display. Okay, next I will install some basic tools I'm using in my day-to-day work. I mainly use them for troubleshooting network issues or just do some research on APIs and stuff. You can Google them if you want, I think they are pretty useful. And I just will install them via the terminal. Okay, I'm now prepared to use Manjaro as my desktop environment if I want to. So time to do a summary and for some additional thoughts here. And we're done. That's basically everything I would do right after the installation. I know there may be other things that can be considered to do, but in my case, the system works fine with these settings. Overall, I think Manjaro is my favorite Linux distribution currently. I know it may switch from time to time. And that's just because I really like the Arch user repository and the great documentation that's available on the internet. So I hope you could learn something. And if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to hit the like button. And please tell me in the comments below, which is your favorite Linux distribution? and if there are any specific topics I should cover on my next videos. And remember, if you want to become an IT professional, don't forget to subscribe to my channel. So thanks again for watching, everybody. Enjoy the rest of your day. Take care of yourself, and I see you soon.